you ever get in there? Are you all right?
I got in there because I heard somebody coming, and no, I'm not all right.
Why are you all hunched over like that?
Hunched over?
Yes. You're not in the safe anymore. Straighten up.
I'll try. That's all I can promise.
I did it. I'm normal.
One time, and you say it ought to go to junk.
Ramsey, you don't have to junk it. It is junk.
It's not that bad. In fact, it's not bad at all for $600.
It's a clunker, and how do you expect to pay $600 and get a good car?
I don't expect a good car. I only want something reliable. Besides, what do you know about it? You're so extravagant. For instance, how much did you pay for this car?
$1,500.
Oh,
$1,500. Plus the engine.
You bought a car without an engine?
Captain, you ought to be congratulated. Never before has a loci been rendered so quiescent.
I will not return to Charon with him, to a land of murdering oppressors.
I told you where you were going. I allowed your fellow countrymen here simply as a courtesy.
And you see how this killer repays you, as he repays all his benefactors.
Benefactors? He's a liar. He raided our homes. Tore us from our families, herded us together like cattle, and then sold us as slaves.
Oh, man, look at that. Look at that.
Taking them off here, boss.
All right, take it off.
Damn things is blocking the scenery.
Oh, man, I'm dying.
She doesn't know what she's doing.
Oh, boy, she knows exactly what she's doing. She's driving us crazy and loving every minute of it.
Summerstock. The excitement and hard work in exploring 6 to 8 different characters in a season of stock was a constant and invigorating test and teacher. The cast rehearses one play during the day and performs a different play that night in front of a paying audience. Some not-so-method shortcuts were necessary. All of those lines from different plays roiling in our brains necessitated a reliance on cliff notes pasted on our makeup mirror. Hat Full of Rain, Me Polo, Fun Loving, In Love with Brother's Wife, but a no-no. Love's Brother, Johnny, Mixed Feelings About Father, Don't Be Too Drunk for the Drunk Scene, Don't Hesitate, Indicate. Is Stanislavski anywhere in there? Sometimes Summerstock spawned other talents. With George Firth in The Matchmaker in 1958, 13 years later, Firth wrote Twigs, his first of 7 plays as a Broadway playwright, most notably 2 for Stephen Sondheim, Company and Merrily We Roll Along. He started writing one acts, which were seen and encouraged at the Actors Studio, and then Eureka. Twigs went from scene work at the studio to the Great White Way. No more summer stock for Firth, not for a lot of us, but for a different reason. There were over 300 equity summer theaters in the 60s. Now there are only 39. It's a loss to actors, directors, playwrights, everyone in every aspect of the theater who could profit from failures and successes. from experience. It's a loss to audiences, to all of us. When I was doing brick on Cat on a Hot Tin Roof at Fishkill in 1958, some guys saw a matinee and wanted me to act in an independent film, very, very low budget, called The Treehouse, to be shot in Sault Ste. Marie in Canada. Paul Sills was the writer, and here's the who's who associated with that film. Irvin Kershner, the director, went on to do movies, including the second Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Back. The producers were Haskell Wexler and his brother Yale. Haskell was also the cinematographer long before he won Oscars for Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf and Bound for Glory. The cast, Barbara Harris, Michael Landon, hot from I Was a Teenage Werewolf, Ed Asner, Barnard Hughes. We doubled up in small hotel rooms, and we all ate family style at one table in a mom and pop diner, except for Landon. I think he was married to a nurse at the time. One afternoon on location, I was awakened from my nap, pulled outside where the camera was pointed at a cabin wall. Kershner was in a hurry. Action! Lou, lean against the wall. But well, why am I just lean against the wall? Now look up and smile. What am I smiling about? What kind of smile? Just look over here, Lou, and smile. Okay, now look mad. Who am I mad at? Why being mad at anybody and for any damned reason? Just look mad. Okay, print. Let's go back inside. My method crumbled to the ground. Stanislavski kicked the dirt in my face. After the 10th day of a 15-day shooting schedule, we were told that the movie was being suspended for a rewrite, and that we'd all be called back. We never were. Hiccups occur in most careers. They are not necessarily career-threatening. Asner, Harris, Hughes, Landon, they all went on to many memorable performances. Within 2 weeks of the Canadian cancellation, I segued into an off-Broadway play. David Ross, a young off-Broadway producer, was getting attention for his fine productions of seldom-produced classics, mostly Chekhov. I was hired by him to play Ava Gabor's lover in Frank Wedekind's Lulu. I jumped into my character with ease and relish for 3 days. I'm going to have to let you go, Lou, Ross said to me after my third rehearsal. I'm fired? How come? You're too young. Ava thinks you make her look old. Don Fellows replaced me. He was in his mid-30s. I was in my early 20s. Too young. Of course, when fired, the actor is always too something. Or not enough something.
Thank you, Mitch. Mitch, that was amazing. Lou, come on. Don't go far.
That was a good reading.
That was a beautiful reading.
God.
Thank you.
That was fantastic.
I was inspired by your words, Lou.
Thank you. So, Lou, I'm going to jump right into, you go to New York from Oklahoma, and we're going to fast forward a little bit, and you started working pretty quickly as an actor. It seems to me from reading your book that there really wasn't this long period of unemployment. Is that the case? Were you fortunate, or how did that all that work?
Well, I was fortunate because I was studying with Lonnie Chapman, and he wrote a play there in the class, and I played the lead in it. But I was out of work, you know, occasionally. I was even an extra once because Lonnie was starring in a summer replacement series in those days. With no rehearsal, you just did it live. And he playing a detective, and he got me an extra job here or there so I could make $50 and stuff. And the great thing was at one point, Lonnie's character is supposed to be angry and picks up a whiskey bottle and throws it. Trouble is, when he did this back, the whiskey bottle broke and all he had was a little handle in his hand, and it was live, And he kind of looked around and went, it was just a sissy throw. I love live television.
How did you find Lonnie? I know you had great teachers. You were studying from three different people at the same time. When you go to New York from another place where it's, you know, basically New York, Oklahoma to New York is another country. Yeah. So how do you discover who to study with and what?
Well, Lonnie had been in a Kazan film, East of Eden. Is that what was it called? East of Eden, yeah. And I knew he was from Oklahoma because he and my cousin Plato were on the same track team at the University of Oklahoma. So I'm walking across the street in Greenwich Village, and there I see this Lonnie Chapman guy. And I went up to him and I said, "Hi, Lonnie, I'm Lou Antoniou." Didn't say a word back, just stood there, trying to get out of my grasp. And I said, "Well, I'm Plato's cousin, Plato Antoniou." Well, then he started talking to me. But that's how I met Lonnie. And then, but he's very taciturn. And then I looked up his phone number in the phone book, West End Avenue, and talked to Irma Dean, his wife, who couldn't have been nicer. "Lonnie, he's related to Plato." And then Lonnie got on the phone. And then he was teaching, so I went and studied with Lonnie.
I know some teachers don't encourage their students to seek work. Some are like, you're learning, this is not the time for you to go out, this is the time for you to be here. What was there, did they have a philosophy when you were there?
Well, Lonnie would only take 15 people in his class. Strasburg would only take 30 in his private class. But no, if you got work, you got work. It didn't come up hardly at all, but mm-hmm. we needed money to pay the rent, even though the rents didn't seem much in those days, they were, because of those days. Yeah. But yeah, Lonnie particularly said, "Hey, listen, you're gonna learn a lot on the set too, you know, not just in the classroom." And he would get people, like Rip Torn was on Broadway and well-known, doing a Tennessee Williams play. And then Rip came in just because he knew Lonnie, and he sat in a chair and started doing a sense memory just because he had to get back to that. And I so admired Rip for doing that. Bunch of kids nobody knew, he didn't know us, and we knew he was on Broadway. I really admired that, working on your craft the whole time.
Your resume is remarkable, your IMDb is remarkable, there's everything that you've done. Not everybody has a sense of community that you have. What do you credit that towards? I mean, that you really, because everybody likes you, as far as I could tell. They really do. And you, just the community with the studio and with Lonnie Chapman and with everybody else, it seemed like there was really, everybody sort of embraced each other. Was that true? And do you think that still exists today?
That's the way my family was. Mm. I had a Greek dad, a beautiful mom, two crazy brothers, Jim being an actor, Theo. At one point, oh, this is kind of funny. I was at the University of Oklahoma, and Jim and I were, he was a drama major, I was a French major. And we were doing, and he had the lead, I forget the name of it. And I played the fat Cockney. It was a well-known play. But Theo, working for Conoco Oil Company, was up in Tulsa doing the Conoco Players production of a play. And so mom and dad had to drive all over Oklahoma to see their three sons acting.
And they loved it?
What?
And they loved it? And they loved
Papa,
it?
Of course, Papa, who had Greek accent, couldn't speak but three words of English when he came to America. He said, "How you learn all those words? How you learn those?" That's what he impressed Papa.
Nice, very nice. And then you mentioned, you have a great conversation about your loft that you had in New York. It was big and it was massive. And how did you find it in this time?
It was on 8th Avenue and around 24th or 25th. And I didn't like living in little teeny apartments. And Jim and I had a little teeny apartment, which I just didn't even like to be in. And I was talking to a friend of mine who was an actress, and she lived there with her boyfriend in this big loft, and he was from the famous Rubenstein family. Nice, smart, wanted to be a writer. And at one point, I think they'd say, okay, we've had enough of the 100-foot loft and the pot-bellied stove. So they moved somewhere where grown-ups live. And I said, can I stay here? And they said, yeah. It was $80 or $86 a month, I think.
Still and, the same.
I had to put in a little 3x4 thing just to have some quiet so I could write and, you know, learn lines and stuff, but I put it up myself. And the bathroom and the kitchen was at the farthest end from the front. And the front was a big 25-foot ceiling, and they had drapes on there that looked like church drapes. I mean, they were beautiful, and the sun would hit them every morning because they faced it. And it was a great way to wake up. Really,
that's fantastic. All right, I'm going to use that as a segue to our next reader, who is the amazing Barbara Bain.
All right, then. Lou, everybody does love you, even if I don't have a cousin named Plato. You know, this is Lou speaking. In 1958, after 2 years in the Air Force, a master's degree in drama from OU, and a season of summer stock in Cologne, Michigan, brother Jim came to New York to chase an acting career. Now I was living in a loft on 8th Avenue and 26th. It was one large room, 100 feet long, heated, only within a 7-foot radius. Yes, by a single pot-bellied stove. The toilet and shower, of course, were some slightly 80 feet away from those 7 feet, and it was illegal to live there. And what with a $50 fine for dumping garbage in a street refuse container, we take our garbage to acting class or to a friend's and unload it. And that's what we would do. And we burned coal in the pot belly, but wood was needed to ignite the coal. There wasn't exactly a lot of spare wood lying around the streets of Manhattan, but I found an infinite supply, however, police barricades, which I'd haul off at 4 in the morning. And in the winter, Jim and I sat around the loft wearing gloves, hats, overcoats, reading, improvising, Peanuts cartoons, or talking about pursuing projects that interested two young Greek boys from Oklahoma. In the 50s and 60s, the Actors Studio was a status symbol sought by actors young and old. A typical year of 2,000 auditioners found only 2 or 3 accepted as members. The process was pain, palm sweating, for it was pain as well, palm sweating. For the preliminary audition, the actors are led up a narrow, darkened stairway into a shadowed room where their acting in a 5-minute scene was evaluated by those non-consoling stares again. The audience, oh, their acting, excuse me, I don't have this a little wrong, was evaluated by unlighted members. If you passed the prelim, next came the final audition, up those non-consoling stares again, knowing this time those shadow judges would be Lee Strasberg, Elia Kazan, and Cheryl Crawford. My first edition was Eugene O'Neill's Desire Under the Elms with the beautiful Barbara Bain. Thank you, Lou. I didn't pass, and Barbara was chosen to do her final with another partner. And for a year after that, I got calls from actors who had passed their preliminary saying the studio had recommended me to do their final with them. I would. Yes, Alice Drummond, whom I'd never met, called me one February day in 1958 and asked if I would partner her for her final at the studio. Warmed by my pot-bellied stove, she and I rehearsed her scene from Tennessee Williams' 27 Wagons Full of Cotton. In the audition, that slight, frail woman slapped me with the force of a welterweight. My head just snapped back, and I spun around the stage, and oh, I got a big laugh, and it hurt, and it felt good. And that night, I got a call from the secretary of the studio saying I had been accepted, but not Alice. Later, she made it all the way. The audition was my fourth trip up those dark stairs. My days and nights at the Actors Studio were an adventure. It gave us a place to take a chance, a place to practice. Some of the chances were a thrill. I mean, Anne Bancroft doing My Fair Lady and singing like a bird, and Eli Wallach doing his periodic Richard III, and George Gaines in a far jump from his roles in Tootsie and the dim-witted commander in the Police Academy movies. Well, he sang an aria from Boris Godunov while working on an emotional memory. Oh, astonishing, astonishing Geraldine Page doing anything. Or watching Marilyn Monroe at the studio, sitting quietly, blue jeans, a sweater, innocent eyes, no makeup, shy. She could have seen from O'Neill's Anna Christie with Maureen Stapleton. And in Strasberg's Private Class, she did Blanche from A Streetcar Named Desire. At that time, 1960, Marilyn Monroe was the most celebrated movie star in the world. Well, she was doing scenes and sensory exercises before a class of 30 unknowns. She once telephoned a fellow classmate, Brooks Morton, in her little girl Marilyn voice. Hello, Brooks. Yeah. I said, Let me take this conversation. Hello, Brooks. Yes. Lee said I should call you about doing a scene with me in class. Well, who is this? This is Marilyn from class. One of the truly positive things about the Actors Studio or any class or any workshop, as Eli Wallach said, and many thereafter, it's my gym. It's where I work out as an actor.
Thank you, Barbara, very, very much.
Yes, tell Lou I love reliving that day.
You tell him yourself.
Oh, dear. I don't know when that was. It was a long time ago, and we were shaking up those stairs.
What was I'm going to leave you guys on for a second. What's harder, auditioning for the studio or auditioning for a role?
Oh, the studio. Don't you think, Lou?
Oh, gosh, yes. Gosh.
Yeah. Well, look who was sitting there. And the standard was so high.
Right.
The reaching for trying to be, spectacular, wonderful, something.
Right.
Special, all of that. It was the standard was very, and it remains so at the studio always.
And you and Marty Landau told me that there were almost 4,000 auditions a year to get into the Actors Studio, yeah. And they would take three or four.
That's right.
So boy, if you got
in. That was fun up those stairs knowing that.
Yeah.
How the legs kept working. I have no idea to this day.
Or I think I'll go back in.
Any voice came out, anything that happened at all was, oh dear.
Do you think part of that is because, sort of build in the frustration to the whole process to see who really is going to stick with it? Or, I mean, what do you think the reason is that there were only, so if you have 4,000 people and you have 1% of the people being let in?
First of all, you have to be not good at math. If you're not good at math, you can survive. You don't want to know the odds, right? You don't want to know the odds at all. You do have it in your head. I don't know. We were very young. We were a little arrogant doing O'Neill in that scene, which was a very ridiculously hard scene. We had a little bit of arrogance going there that we could even try to do that scene. We didn't do a nice little chat scene in a tea house, having tea or something. A very, very difficult and demanding scene. I don't know. There was maybe that in it. There was something about our desire to do such a play as Desire Under the Elm struck them. We never found out what they thought, other than they did pass me for the preliminary, and that was.
Do you think through the years that the passion? I don't know if that's the right word, but I know people who have. Auditioned for this studio in LA, and they didn't get in the first time, and they said, "That's it, I'm done. I'm not." Is that what is that? I see you shaking your head.
It's called stubborn.
Stubbornness?
It's called very, very, yes, dedicated. And Lou, nothing was going to stop you. Nothing.
Neither one of us.
No.
But the thing about the audition in L.A. is that the people would come in and we would be judging, and there would be a guy's name, and this would be his 10th audition for the Actors Studio. He still hadn't passed, you know. So they don't give up. That, like Barbara and I, just we didn't give up.
Right. No. Lou, I want to ask you.
Yeah.
Especially, Barbara, you could stick around. You could come back. We're all going to come back, completely up to you. So... this question is to Lou, and that is that throughout your book, not only are you acting and then later directing, but you also, you have a lot of ambition, and it's that you talk about that you and Jim were trying to option a property, and then you sat down and you started to write. Where did all that come from?
Well, I don't know. I've never been analyzed, but yeah. Mainly it was fun.
Right.
I mean, when Jim and I would sit around in the loft around the pot-bellied stove, and we wanted to, and Jim had the idea of doing a movie about the cowboy singer, and so we went and tried to find out if we could get an option, and the option was $7,500 we didn't make in those days. So, and then Jim says, "Oh, it's okay, Patty Chayefsky's option," and he's writing a screenplay of it. Barbara wants to say something.
Sorry. Yeah, Barbara.
Yeah, well, I was going to say different. I was very academically streamed as a young person. I was good at school. I could do everything fast. Nothing felt satisfying. I could just do it. So what? And teachers would fuss over it. And I felt like I hadn't done anything. Mm-hmm. I started dancing before I was an actress. And that was my first love. And when I first started to work as an actress, it first started classes, I couldn't do it. I loved that. I was challenged. I couldn't believe how hard I'd have to work to try to get anything, any little crumb that, for instance, Lonnie or Lee saw in me, they kind of encouraged me.
Right.
I worked very hard because I liked that. I liked that it was hard. Everything else was easy. Dance wasn't easy. Dance was hard as well. And I liked that. I liked it. Hit myself against something really hard and see what I could come up with. That made life very exciting for me.
That's great.
It was a very different thing.
Did you find that, Lou, did you find that with writing? Was writing a challenge to you, or was writing just another skill set?
No. When I was 16 years old in Oklahoma City, I was a sports writer getting paid for the biggest newspaper in Oklahoma, with the byline, and they also gave me a car to drive for myself. And at 16, I was writing.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's in the book. But it's also, I was on, when going through junior high, I wrote for the school paper. Senior high, I wrote for the school paper. And not only was I editor, but I had a sports column called, get this, you'd see a pair of sunglasses, binoculars, and whatever the season was, there'd be a reflection of a football, and then the next season would be a baseball, and I call it Lou's Views.
Oh, all right.
Very nice. Now, because you were a journalist at such a young age, did that help you create a voice as an actor, or are those two completely separate things?
That's a good question. I don't know, but I know that sometimes somebody will read something that I wrote and say, well, that's the way you talk. Now, in class, though, in Central High School, the woman who was a head of journalism, we printed our own papers there. I mean, it was that kind of school. Mm-hmm. You learned woodwork, you learned how to fix a car and how to print. And so I would write. But one time I wrote a column because an all-star football player named Billy Vessels was at OU, and his brother was looking for a high school to go to in Oklahoma City. And he came in, snobby little bastard, and I said, God, I hope he goes to class in high, you know. But unfortunately, I wrote in my column, Lou's views, that Jacobson, who was our football coach, and I was a football player on the team, he wasn't much good, and we had a 4-6 record. And my column was, why should he come here? We only won 4 games this year. And boy, did I get called in to the principals and to the woman.
We're going to jump to our next reader, who is very special to you, to your daughter, Elkin Antoniou. Okay, maybe. Wow. So, Elkin, I'm going to jump in. Elkin and Barbara, I'm going to turn off my video if you would as well. And Elkin, it's all you.
Thank you. Todd, this is fantastic. What a gift. So, tomorrow, go see Albie and Alan Schneider about his new play. It was for Edward Albee's adaptation of Carson McCullough's novella, The Ballad of the Sad Cafe. I didn't have to read for it, perhaps because of my having done Albee's zoo story at the Actors Studio. I did have to meet the director, Alan Schneider. Colleen Dewhurst was set to play the lead, and she's a big woman. So just in case, I stuffed some newspaper in my shoes to make me an even 6 feet tall. Garson Kanin once asked my height, and when I said 5'11", he advised, always say 6 feet. Albie had final casting approval and the meeting was pleasant and short. October 30th, opening night, I am nervous. Totally cool 4 years ago in my New York debut, but since then nervousness knocks and has risen with each succeeding play. It is not a loss of confidence. It's just that through training and experience, I'm demanding more from myself, more character complexities, more nuance. The one note that Brother Jim reiterates is, in your curtain calls, smile. I'm usually thinking of something I could have done better in the performance or something I'll go for next time. My father came to New York to see me in the play. He had arrived at Ellis Island 45 years earlier and not been to New York since. It was the only time he saw me on Broadway. Dewhurst told me that after the show, Papa, along with my brothers Jim and Theo, came to her dressing room to congratulate her on her performance. Also in the room was two-time Academy Award winner, Shelley Winters. Shelley, to Papa, your son is very good in the play, Mr. Antoniou. Yeah, what do you do? Well, I'm an actor too. Papa, patting her arm. Well, you stick with it, you make it. Shelley graciously accepted the encouragement. Albie got it half right, and gratefully his talent vision. Sorry, Edward, but thank you. President Kennedy was killed on Friday, November 22nd, and that night, Broadway went dark. We played the matinee the next day, and when Miss Amelia pointed her shotgun at Marvin Macy, well, it took Colleen and me momentarily out of the play and sent a chill through us. The audience gasped. Everyone in the theater was suspended in the image of the assassination. As in a silent dream, the room was soundless. Whew. It's very touching. You wrote it.
That was beautiful. Thank you. So, Lou, I wanted to sort of segue that into, I know as your book goes on from that point on, you talk about how attendance had dropped in Broadway because of the assassination. And obviously right now, in our world right now, Broadway's closed for the first time in history. Yeah. What was it that brought everybody back into the theater? I mean, obviously it wasn't a pandemic, but what brought people back into the theater back in the 60s?
Well, I'm not sure they ever left the theater.
Okay.
Tennessee was hot and we were doing Tennessee Williams plays and I always forget his name, but he wrote that thing about the father, with the sons.
Oh, yeah.
No, but it just, no one ever left the theater in New York in those days.
You're talking Arthur Miller?
Yes, thank you. Yes. Yeah, that one, All My Sons, yeah. And we just never got enough of those playwrights. The plays were wonderful. And they used to, you'd rehearse a play, and then you'd go out of town and do it in front of an audience and not with no New York critics or anything. And then that got too expensive. So even though the actor's salaries got cut and we had to pay for our own room and board and hotel room, so we were dying to get back in New York. But what we would learn about the play, you couldn't learn just by reading it or rehearsing it. The audience told us mostly what to do and told the playwright and the director mostly what to do. But a live audience does that. It helps you every time. And every one of them is different, as you know. One night, they won't laugh at a line. The next night, they will. They're entirely different. David Wayne, and another famous actor, deadpan comedy actor, wrote for the Theater Arts magazine on that they would call each other, they were friends, at the end of every night. If it rained, they got less laughs. If the headlines were bad, less laughs. If America was in a better mood, why, they wouldn't stop laughing. I mean, the audience has told you what to do.
Right. So your theater career is, I would say, it's going well. You could define it any way you want when you started going back and forth between the East Coast and the West Coast. So you're working a lot in theater, and then all of a sudden you're doing TV. You're flying back to the West Coast and TV.
Yeah, you had to make a living. And it was hard to do that on stage, and particularly off Broadway, in which it was $30 a week salary, only because they had to pay as much as unemployment insurance. And if unemployment went up, off Broadway salaries went up. But you couldn't, and plus you would do a weekend, you'd do four plays over a week. You'd do Friday and Saturday, you'd do two performances each day. And by the eighth performance of the week, that's the one I enjoyed the most, because I had learned so much doing the other six performances, and I was learning. So it was never ideal of staleness. Even Colleen, when we opened in Bella to the Sad Cafe, you know, all the actors, it was just the legend of you go to Hardy's restaurant and wait for the reviews. And the reviews started coming in, and they were smash. Everybody, in those days, it was like eight New York City papers. And every one of them was a smash except Walter Kerr. And for the Trib, he's the only one who didn't like it. But Colleen, bless her heart, the old pro that she is and was, couldn't wait to get up early and go stand in front of the box office and see that line form, she said. Delightful, wonderful woman, gosh. And what was your chance marriage to George C. Scott, for goodness sake?
You talk a lot about George C.
Yeah. Wonderful.
What was your transition into directing? So you're doing theater, you're going to L.A., and then
yeah, at the Actors Studio in New York, I got interested in some novels written by British playwrights, and I cast it there and directed it, because I adapted it from the books into a 15-20 minute scene and directed it. And Lee Strasberg, I'm told, hated that. He didn't want to lose me. And Arthur Storch came up to me after a blistering last line from Lee, after he saw something I directed that I had adapted. He said, so after the actors would have been better off without you. Well, Arthur Storch came over, put his arm around, and said, don't pay any attention to him. He just wants you to be an actor so he can have some sort of control over you. But so that's where I started directing. I enjoyed it so much. Just it's a thing that you just learn growing up a certain way. You learn to help people, and that's what a director was supposed to do. And the actors at the studio knew me and trusted my judgment because they'd seen me act. And so it was a nice, gentle, I didn't just jump in, you know. I picked a few things, and then finally ended up writing a musical and directing it at the studio.
That's great. So just so everybody knows, you know, we have a long career. We're probably gonna go a couple minutes late. If you could stick around, that would be fantastic, but we're just gonna keep on talking. And right now I'm going to go to Jennifer Lassalette, and she's going to come in with our last reading. So Jennifer, it's all you.
Hi. Elizabeth Taylor limped into my life in 1983. She'd just returned from her peace mission to Israel as she recovered from a car accident in the Holy Land. Newspapers across the world front-paged her smiling, gamely neck embrace in a wheelchair. Taylor had many accidents in her life. Some were life-threatening, some were marriages. I was to direct her in an HBO movie in Toronto, Nobody Makes Me Cry. For 3 weeks, I scouted locations, auditioned Canadian actors, chose key crew personnel. The writer producers, they were snorting at the gate, ready to go, when whoops, the movie's insurance company wouldn't insure Ms. Taylor. Neck brace, wheelchair, Peace Mission Pictures. She was out. HBO placed our heads under the cancellation guillotine. Unless we could find a star to replace her, the blade would drop. We immediately suggested calling Dewhurst for their approval. We got no. Okay, how about Geraldine Page? No. Okay, how about either you get us a star or forget about it, like Anne Margaret or Mary Tyler Moore? Well, Carol Burnett wanted to do the co-starring part. Wasn't that enough? Not for HBO. They demanded two stars, movie stars. HBO proclaimed itself bigger than TV, but movie stars knew their close-ups would get smaller on HBO. Anne Margaret turned us down. Kim Novak said no. And that late night pizza meetings were clogging our arteries and our hopes. Despair. A phone call. Elizabeth Taylor's agents had made a deal with the insurance company. For the first 3 days of any Elizabeth Taylor illness or incapacity that halted production, Taylor would have to pay $70,000 a day. She wasn't on her Cleopatra salary anymore. And even though this was television, this gig was important to Taylor. It could prove she was fit enough emotionally and physically to work. Later, I learned that friends such as Robert Wagner had guaranteed any loss. She was bailed out, Carol Burnett signed on, and the snow fell on some cold and happy people in Toronto. That's the kind of man Wagner was. I had the good fortune of working with him on This Gun for Hire, the movie of the week version of the 1942 film. I like it when a good guy or gal gets wonderful reviews, and RJ got them.
Thank you, Jen. That's fantastic. So I could actually talk forever, but I'm going to open this up to the house a little bit and let you guys ask some questions. So we're going to start with Stu Berg. I see, Stu, you have your hand up. So if you want to unmute yourself, otherwise I'm just going to keep on going. There you go, Stu.
I'm going to stop you from keeping on going. You know, it goes without saying that, you know, Lou is one of the most talented people I've ever met in my life as an actor, as a director. And I'm very close and have been for more years than I care to admit to both Jim and Lou. And the one thing I'd like to do is I'd like to tell you what a truly generous guy he is. And sure. When he was mentioning, well, I've never tried to borrow money from you, Lou, but outside of that, I think it's, I did get to spend the night in your bed. I resent you weren't there, but that's another story. But I did want to say, I did want to say that in terms of his generosity as and wonderful person that he is, I had a pretty successful career directing television commercials. And I always had the itch. I think probably it was because Jim and I were very good friends and had been stationed up in Alaska together. And and Lou was very instrumental in terms of helping me get there, and Jim as well. And he was the one that turned me on to Paul Richards and to take acting lessons. And I found out very quickly that I wasn't that that adept at that. But this one thing that always stuck in my mind, two things, and then I'll shut up. One was that through Lou, I was able to get an interview with his agent, who was one of the top directing agents in town. The man, Peter, I can't remember his last name, but he wasn't interested in putting me on. He had enough people who he could get work for. And the other thing was is that Lou said that if I did get a gig and I was on, the people were unhappy with me, that he would step in and finish it for whatever the amount of money that they were willing to pay me. And I've never forgotten those things. And I love both those guys. And anyway, Lou, it's a great book and you're a pretty great guy.
Thank you, Stu. I'm gonna go to Lisa Robbins. So Lisa, just unmute yourself, there you go.
Hi. Oh, thank you so much for doing this, Todd. And thank you, Lou. It's just such a joy to hear more details about your life and to see everybody. Hi, Barbara. It's just so nice to see you. Oh, my God. I just wanted to thank you so much, Lou, for turning your time and your energy and your heart over to the Actors Studio these past number of years. It's just been such a joy, and I'm so grateful that you've come over and been spending time with us over there, and we learned so much and we have so much fun. So it's just a joy to know you. And he's one thing that not everybody knows, but I'm sure Barbara does. He's one hell of a dancer too. Can't wait to see you back on the dance floor.
Thanks, Lise. And since you bring this up, so Lou moderates the director's unit on the West Coast at the Actors Studio. He also has a Wednesday acting unit. I don't know the official name of the Wednesday, Lou. What is the official name?
The Wednesday
name?
Class.
It's called Wednesday Class.
The Wednesday Session.
There you go, the Wednesday Session.
And that's just for actors. Yes. Actors, I mean, anybody can sit in on it. But right. Nobody comments other than myself. And they can always comment in the parking lot. But because in that session, in my Wednesday session, they do the scene and then we work on it right there. We don't say, oh, good or bad or anything. I whisper little things to them. And the actors love it because, oh, I never thought of that. They know, and bingo, you just see a transformation many times in what these actors are really capable of and enjoy themselves up there. And the motto is, you're not here to please an audience. Do the work. Just do the work. And it's a great place. I'm truly glad we got one out here.
Oh, I'm thrilled. And our Tuesday director session is the highlight of my week. So absolutely. I'm going to go to Mitch Levine. So turn on your video. And Mitch, you have a question.
Hey, Lou. You know, it's remarkable to me what you bring to our art and the way you share craft. They're both so vital, I think, in the development of actors. And I wonder if you could talk about two things. The first being what your idea of mentorship is through your role at the studio and your role in life in terms of nurturing actors, and what your counsel is for how to begin the process. After you read that script for the very first time, what are your first steps in imagining the realization of those words on the page to something that's living on the screen or on stage?
That's a hell of a question, Mitch. And since you're such a good director, you know where you go. When the first time I read a script, I just read a script as a guy who wants to be entertained. No fuss, no bother, just in having a good time going with the writer. Then I read it again as a guy who's going to direct it or act it either way. But then the thoughts and the observations are different. And we ask the same old question, who, what, when, where. What is the writer trying to say? Is he saying it? Does it need this? And then you start analyzing, make little notes. I'll read a play three or four times before I start giving notes to the playwright. And because each time I see it a different way and I don't want to see it the same way. And it's because we have such talented writers and directors at the studio that sometimes you don't have to say anything. They'll just do it. And then would you say, well, okay, now do it again, but this time, you know, try this. And it's wonderful to be, well, I'm a strong family man anyway. And that so that interaction with the other people is from me and most of us there, the friendliest, the most helpful thing. There's a lot of people that do that finger pointing and, well, you should have, but I found out long ago that from working as an actor and particularly as a director, I try never to say no. I, rather than saying, oh no, that's no good, say, gosh, you know, that was really good. Now let's try. I use a lot of what ifs. What if he's on his way to Dallas from Fort Worth? It's just, it's, you know, give it. And then, or another one I learned from Kazan was, has such and such ever happened to you? Have you ever been in a crowd and someone just fainted? And that, and that'll lead him then to what might happen. Also, Kazan, you learned, listen, I had some of the best teachers that I studied. And one time I was acting in America on a location in Greece, and I was playing a jerk. And I was supposed to be drunk. And it was, gave me a jug, so nothing he could see. And Kazan was known for the tricks he would play on some of his actors and not telling them that they were a trick. He saw it off a board once in Baby Doll when Carol Baker, who's brand new, was supposed to walk over and Eli was chewing her out. He wasn't getting the reaction from Carol Baker that he wanted. So he said, all right, take one. And he had the carpenters come and barely saw off one of the boards. Didn't look like it was sawed. I just it didn't saw it off. He saw it a little bit on the board. So when she's in the scene and Eli's off camera and she's walking over to him and steps on that board and it goes through. Her leg goes down through it. And Eli just, he knew what the guy was up to. He worked with him, I don't know how many times. But you just learn from watching so much. And one of the things that I decide that any artist, you learn so much through observation. And Kazan used to have, always had a little notebook and pencil in his pocket. And one time when I was telling him about my mom and dad, and I said, Papa, who's Greek, and he called Mama the white woman. He said, the white woman coming in? And his hand went into his pocket, pulled it out, and he just started making a note of that, that he sometime might use it. I mean, that's the way he was. So as an actor and anybody, actor, writer, director, that's what you do. Don't let any moment pass by. Get involved in it. Remember it. That's, we all artists do that. Painters, what flashes in their head, how do I get that on canvas?
That's a beautiful guide to our lives as artists. Thank you.
Barbara, yes.
I just want to mention that I still, of course, am attached and go to the studio, much to see Lou on the Wednesday session. One of the reasons that session draws me so is it is always, I think of it as a dynamite experience. And when I say dynamite, I mean, because there's always an explosion of ideas, of inspiration, of talent, of unexpected. Oh, didn't think of that. Always going on inside of you all the time. So it's very alive. It's very exciting. It's very dynamic. And Lou, I told you some time ago, you know, you were a cute boy when I first met you. You grew into some kind of genius in the art form, which you guide us with a generosity of spirit that I think you may have always had. But certainly we were in a crucible with Lonnie Chapman, and that was his class that we shared together so long ago. He was always encouraging, even any little crumb that happened on the stage, he'd help that actor move to the next crumb we might find lucky. And that was always, in an odd way, there was a kind of combination of that and what I call greed, because we were brought up also by Strasberg, who no matter what you did, he wanted more. So we were always searching for that more. And that more is very exciting, because when we find it, it's a gem. And it's like, ooh, so the puzzle is never solved. with any material you get. It's new material, and there are more puzzles to solve. And that keeps it so alive and so wonderful. And that's what you own and bring to us. So I just want to, I get a chance to tell you all this right out in the world instead of in the parking lot.
Well, a couple more minutes. So we're going to go, long. I do have Devik Stell asks, does music play a part? Does it influence your choices as an actor? So his question is for Lou, did music play a part influencing your choices as an actor?
Not much, but sometimes I would purposely use it centrally. One time I noticed that I was walking from at the studio, I was walking from stage left to stage right, and with not the, I had a thought in my head, but it wasn't stimulating me. So I started thinking of a song that I thought would help. Just hearing it. And Devik is good, but he has a band and everything. He responds to music. We have to respond to every sense we have anyway. And sometimes I would rely, look at the rhythm of a character's walk. Mm-hmm. And once, if it was eluding me, I'd find some music, and suddenly if I did the walk in a certain gait, in a certain rhythm, some of the character would come to me. Mm. So it's I find it very useful, and I don't mean this in, like in movies, they do it to make you cry or tell you what the scene's about, but I mean to help the actor, it's very important.
Sure, sure. Let's go to Sandra Curry.
Oh my.
So Sandra, just unmute yourself. There you go.
I unmuted myself. I think a lot of people may not be aware of the fact that both Barbara and Lou were really instrumental, two of the most instrumental people, in even bringing the studio to the West Coast. So it's really our luxury that they had the passion and enthusiasm, the commitment, and curiosity to not only bring it out, stay with it, and inspire us continuously. You guys, both of you guys, really, it's just one of the greatest gifts we possibly have. So this is a wonderful evening, Todd, that you
thanks, Sandra.
And Lou, we love you a lot. And Barbara, you too, both of you guys are really the energy behind those sessions and inspiring us. So I have to say thank you.
Oh, thank you, Sandra. It's always a pleasure. I just had someone. I had someone with their hand up, and then it went away. So sorry, I didn't get to you quick enough. There you go. We'll go a couple more minutes. If anybody has any more questions, just let us know for a couple more minutes, and then you guys can all go out to dinner, which is probably to your kitchen. But yeah, that's it. So fantastic. Lou, in your book, it's really funny. You talk about, and this is coming from somebody who did not grow up on horses, but you in the early in your career, I don't know if it was Gunsmoke or whatnot, you have a lot of associations with horses. Were you, I'm going to assume because you're from Oklahoma, you know how to ride a horse. Is that true?
Oh, yes. I was in high school, and one summer, I was able to get a job on a ranch that a doctor owned in Oklahoma, and just jumped on a horse and started riding. No one said, oh, put your knees here, put your knees there. I learned all that later when I started riding English saddle. But it's I just jumped into it because that's what you did. If something came along that paid you a salary, by law, you learned to do it.
How many times was that special skill utilized in your acting career?
What aspect of it?
Of riding. So did
riding. Yeah, Gunsmokes. I acted in a lot of guns. And then there was one with David Soul and Bobby Sherman. That was a Western. And I direct that. And even just, I don't know, showing off or something. But I had the dolly in front of them at full gallop. and I galloped off camera right next to them just to watch them see they weren't hamming it up or trying to act faces or something. And so, yeah, and I enjoyed. Oh, but this is the funny one. I had a stunt guy, Fred Lerner, who did all my stunts, and then I would hire him to be the stunt coordinator on the things I directed. And there was one point where the actor comes in and the horse rears up. And now I didn't know. I said, "Well, I don't know if the actor, you don't want to, an actor with a broken leg and everything closes down." And I couldn't find Fred anywhere, so I did it. So I rode the horse and put on the hat and all that, put on the hat, came to my mark, pulled on the reins, leaned forward, and went up on his hind legs, and we got the shot. So sometimes you just do more than you want to do, but it has to be done.
You know, we can, Peter, I had you and then you ventured. Oh, wait, there you go. You're back. All right. Peter Flood, just unmute yourself.
Is he talking?
Okay. I just wanted to ditto what Sandra said to both you, Lou, and to Barbara about gratitude for you guys, the inspirational presence. And for the studio in general, I mean, not in general, but specifically as an institution that's unique in what it offers people who participate in it on so many levels. And my question really now is, how are you coping with the present moment? And what do you see ahead? I mean, we're all in the same boat, basically. I think it's clear we all miss each other in the in-person presence and the processes that depend on that. But I'm just curious how you're doing in this period and how you're using your time.
Well, thank you, Peter. I'm great regard for the number one, your insights and as a writer into a short piece that we've never seen before. Well, I always wait for Peter, who seems to have a knack, a knowledge about what the scene needs in terms of the script. And it doesn't make a big fuss. And Peter is such a gentle speaking guy, and I've never heard him raise his voice, and he'll come right to it. And the studio has people like that. And when we get somebody like Peter, who's a director, but he is so good in that area of seeing a brand new from the playwrights unit, something, and he just very calmly and offer a little suggestion and you say, that's it, that's what it needs. And so when we run into people like Peter, and it's just a place where so much of us is called for and called from, that it's not just there as an actor, not just there as a playwright, so forth. It just seems to, we're immersed. It seems like our whole being is immersed in the arts, even though we may not be any good at it. We learn from what we're not good at, from the people that do know what they're doing.
Thank you, Lou. Thank you for thank you, Peter. I just want to acknowledge. This is awesome. Yoko Narahashi says, "This is so wonderful. Thank you so much. Such love, inspiration. Thank you from Japan. From Japan. So." Thank you, Yoko. It's we love having you. Thank you for dialing in. And to everybody else, Jonathan Levitt, John Solari, it was great. Bruce Robinson, Claire. So thank you, guys. It's a little after, it's 10 after 6. If nobody has anything else, then we're going to wrap it up. To everybody on screen, I am going to send you a quick link just so we can have a sort of like a thank you wrap up. So check your email after we close up. And it's just going to be a quick mazel tov kind of thing. And other than that, I want to thank everybody out there for coming back on every Friday. We love having you. Lou, I can't thank you enough across the board, one for joining us tonight and the other for being Lou.
Indeed.
It really is. It really is.
Bravo, Luigi.
Yes. It really is. And Barbara, such a gift. Thank you for being here. And Mitch, we love you. What can I say? Jennifer and Elkin, you're off somewhere in the wings. Thank you for all your help and for being here. How cute is that? To everybody in the audience, thank you so much, and we'll see you next week. Okay. Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Thanks, Todd.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.